All right. Hi, everyone. And it's my pleasure to talk again. I'm back with a new topic today that we'll be talking about some common traps that GMAT has often been following from a long time, where the experts, the aspirants are always entangled with. And yes, we'll be for the next 1.5 hours, we'll be only talking about this trap. To make it more interactive, I would request everyone to be a part of it and throw the comments and the questions, because I have a proper access to, you know, the YouTube as well. So I'll be checking up your comments and we'll be discussing a lot about this. And today, let's find a way where we can definitely demystify DS so that, you know, it becomes easy for us to score much better than what we are scoring right now. So I'll start with sharing the screen and the presentation starts. And this is where we start our main agenda for the day. All right, so what we're dealing here today is the quant traps, exactly, which are set by the GMAT. And how are we gonna overcome these traps? How do we gonna identify the traps? Is through the variable approach. So this is one of the name that shouldn't be new to some people who have attended my last session. But yes, definitely, I'll be talking in details about these approaches today. So by the end of the day, it would be as friendly name to you for your journey with GMAT. There are a couple of jargons that are there in today's session. So I'll go very slow. So any moment if I'm rushing, any moment if you guys want to, you know, re-listen to something, just put your comments onto the chat window and definitely I'll try covering up as much as I can. So the first thing first that comes to my mind is like, why do GMAT, you know, actually talk about the traps? I mean, like, why do they have to set the traps? Why is it not that easy for them to put across certain questions from math, which we have any which ways, you know, studied during our high school or colleges, maybe, or during any sort of advanced course that we go through, maybe engineering, calculus, finance, or something. So, you know, the motto behind taking the GMAT is not only the exam clearance, but getting into a top class university to pursue one of the better courses that deals into the practical application. So you become more pragmatic. And when you pursue that courses, therein where you actually deals with the real type challenges and the situation. So it is pretty sure that you don't have to deal with the long calculations. You won't have much amount of time to deal with those, you know, situations or problems. You have to be on your toes to come up with certain data collections, certain data analysis, maybe in such a way to understand that whether that problem can be solved or how that problem can be solved. Similarly, if I talk in terms of GMAT about all the statements that I have spoken right now, solving math is not difficult until we just bush around. And what I mean by that is, like, if we don't think about to get out of our comfort zone in solving any particular question, be it an easy or a hard one, we are actually restricting our minds to get to know the new methods, what we so-called as quick approaches to, you know, solve the questions. GMAT wants you to do that. They actually want you to think beyond what you could think about to actually, you know, deal with the statements, to deal with the conditions, to deal with the questions. Today, we'll be talking only on the basis of DS, data sufficiency, because that is one thing that I have been exposed to recent times. When I'm talking to a lot of students these days over a one-on-one live session, what I get to know about the fact is every aspirant is as good as you all who have joined in today. And they're pretty making Q45, 46. But again, the confidence is not that high about the consistency. So you know, after 7 days or maybe bi-weekly, when they perform into a mock test, it gets bombed out and they end up at 39 maybe in queue, or maybe something which they cannot even expect about. So what is this gap exactly all about? The gap is all about the approach. If you're more conventional to anything in this real-time world, and when I'm talking about a real-time world that is 2020, we are not in the far decades of 2000. We are in 2020. The things are quick. The things are communicated quickly, and we have a lot of resources. We have been growing in terms of technology. But what is happening is, like, you know, we are not trying to get out of a comfort zone, and this is what it happens with math. If I'm a person solving a lot of questions, or if I'm a person who is solving one question in 10 or 12 steps, and if I'm comfortable getting the answer correctly, what I assume is this is the only method that can lead me to the final answer, which is a correct answer. And therein where I'm making a bondage to my mindset. I'm not ready to think over. But does GMAT gives you that much amount of time to write those 10, 12 steps to solve the questions? Readily not. So this is why I'm lucky enough that I got hold of this particular approach, therein where I've studied them in details and I've mastered them over the years to get through the approaches. And today it's my pleasure that, you know, I've been introducing this to all of you who have joined right now, and every one of them who would, you know, look to this particular video in the near future. Take my words, this approaches will make your life easy and you would no more fall for any sort of traps in DS. So going ahead with the same, I'll be talking about some common mistake types. Now, this is one of the word that I'll be using almost in my every statement today. And CMT is the shortcut for it. So please excuse me if I use the word CMT anywhere. Please try relating it to that I'm talking about common mistake types. And we'll go through this common mistake types one by one. And then we'll understand it, you know, how it could be so beneficial for us to, you know, deal with the DS questions, especially the traps. So this is something which I've already spoken about, the GMAT. It requires your math, your verbal, your reasoning skills, true, and understands the tricks and the logic of the quant. So logically, again, you know, you need to be very good when it comes to concepts. Your concepts intact has to be very strong, and then in where you can try getting accurate and time-bounded. And these are absolutely, you know, math's revolutions for mistake common types, which are CMTs that we'll be dealing about. So this is one thing that we'll start our session today with. And I'll appreciate if you got a pen and a paper to make note of certain important things, because that will be very, very beneficial for you. And of course, yes, for the more details, you can often visit to our website, that is www.mathrevolution.com. And therein where after sign up, you can definitely, you know, go through the, you know, the details about these approaches, because it does take time to master, but again, it's not that difficult to. So let's start with this. The first thing first, which I see on the left, is CMT1, which is a common mistake type one, which says that no is also an answer and it is sufficient. I agree to this fact that every one of you, or mostly 95% of you people, would know that no is also an answer. But let me tell you, even the brighter student who has been reading math throughout his childhood till yet make mistakes with when it comes to this, because we have been looking always for a yes as an answer, and there in where we make a mistake to it. Secondly, when we assume that yes could be the only answer, or if suppose the question asks is x greater than zero, and if I could say yes, it is greater than zero, then what I'm doing is I'm minding again my mindset blocking to no as an answer. So when I get a block here, I don't try putting up values which can be less than zero, and therein where I cannot get the x in comparison to zero. So this is one thing that we'll be talking about in details today. Common mistake type two, which is this particular portion that we're dealing today, it must be only one answer. Now see, this is something, if I differentiate here, what sort of the question would I get? So CMT1 will always open with an open-ended question, maybe like is or whether x is divisible by 5. And CMT2, when it says it has to be only one answer, that is what its uniqueness is, it should be more or less a closed-ended question, like what could be the value of a number n when divided by 9, and there are certain conditions attached to it. So this is how I differentiate between the CMT1 and CMT2. Going ahead with common mistake type 3 and common mistake type 4. Now, this is something which are a bit trickier, and therein where it holds a lot of exceptions that one has to master. So journey with CMT1 and CMT2 will be much easier. But CMT3 and CMT4, once you master this, let me tell you, you have win over the time. And when I say when you have win over the time, that means you have enough amount of time to solve your DS question. You can think beyond the boundaries of what the question is asking. And the possibility of you marking an answer wrong would be as minimal as possible. And then CMT4 is being divided into two individual parts, which says 4 of A and 4 of B. Now, it is more likely, and this is all depends upon the chances of one to be an answer out of 5 options that we get through. So, yes, this is something which we're going to talk about in our later portion of today's session. Now, CMT1 and CMT2 occurs in all DS questions. So what does it mean? So either your DS question would be open-ended or it would be a closed-ended. So this is wherein, you know, this particular statement justify my logic. Secondly, it appears as a logical query. So that is pretty okay. Is or whether or find is 3 of the terms which you could often look forward to. CMT3 and CMT4, again, it's a common mistake type 3 and 4 that we'll be talking about and solving the questions on. They're not actual appearing in all the DS questions. So now from here, the trick starts. If they're not appearing in all the DS questions, then there has to be some particular set of questions in which I would be able to apply this, and therein where I will be able to get out of the trap. So what are those sort of questions that I have to be very, very much aware about before we start talking about in details about these approaches? So you need to always, always keep into your mind that there are certain questions which are based on integers, statistics, probability, inequalities, and absolute value. You need to be very, very careful with this sort of questions, because these questions which actually involve the application of common mistake type 3 and 4, the details are to be followed for the same. This is again a very basic thing which you most of you know, that you know there for the 14 DS questions that happens into the GMAT exam, the real GMAT, the CMT1 and CMT2 would be practically applicable, and questions dealing with no as an answer are rarely appearing. So this is also a clue to us that you know yes could be the major answer, but again it has to be sufficient enough to give me the outcome. When it comes to CMT3 and CMT4, they appear about 4 times after question number 17. Now see, when you know this, you are actually mapping your mind and your mental state of taking the test and when it should appear and how it would appear. But CMT4 times appears more frequently, so this is something. So any moment now when you appear for your next mock or a full mock, just make sure that you know you can try catching these 2 points, and then you'll be definitely comfortable with it. So how do we identify, I mean, like what are the methods that can help us to identify this common mistake types? So when we talk about the first method here, so it says us very clearly that it appears on all the DS questions. So you know, it says here the common mistake type 3 and 4, when we'll talk about this into details, it is often an answer that deals with the integers. I'm again repeating it. You can definitely make a note of it. These are the questions which are based on integers. And I want to look this particular word in the question. If it says it's a number, if it's a positive number, that is not common mistake type 3 trap. Okay. So make sure that, you know that these are the words that is integers are very much common word. Statistics that deals with standard deviations, range, median is something easy. Probability, we know that conditional probability is the major portion that would come here. Then we have inequalities, and then we have an absolute value question. At times, you will have a mix of both, wherein the absolute value questions are being surfaced with inequality. Talking about this, the statistics questions with the phrase different positive integers. Make sure you have proper understanding of these three words, which says different positive integers, distinct positive integers. Therein where we are able to understand that, you know, what we are dealing with. Because if there happens to be same, you know, the concept of median, range, and standard deviation changes. When they happens to be different, then we all know that what could be the logic behind solving for standard deviation. So let's start up today's session with first type, that is common mistake type 1 and common mistake type 2. As I already told you about the fact that, you know, it's all about that there should be only one answer, first of all. So that is wherein, you know, maybe is not the condition, but no is also an answer. So it's not only yes that we look forward to. Either the answer could be yes or a no, but no, I'll repeat myself. It has to be a unique yes or unique no. So there should not be two set of, you know, data values, two set of numbers, therein where a single variable is getting for yes or they are getting no. If that happens, then, you know, you will always end up saying maybe it is greater, maybe it is not. So if that is one thing, then this particular answer cannot be found out, and that particular you know, condition alone may not be sufficient. So let's try one of the questions on this, and let's see. So initially we will not much be trying to get the answer through. We'll be trying to relate it through which common mistake type it is pointing towards, because I know you guys know pretty well how to solve the questions, and you'll be lending to a proper answer. But the question that I have been starting is a very basic, wherein I can talk more about the application. Now see, this particular question starts with a word called is x greater than 0. Now the only answer to it would be either a yes or a no. When I say this yes or a no, it has to be a unique answer. Certain situations giving me yes and certain situations giving me no will not suffice my requirement. So is x greater than 0? What does it mean? X has to be positive. Now see, this is what I'm able to think upon, because I know this fact that these answers would be either a yes or a no, but not both. Then I can think upon that it has to be a positive. That is a hidden actually meaning of this particular variable. So if I go to the condition number 1, which gives me negative 1 and 1, I, without showing you the solution, even you know how to solve this particular question now. When I have a negative and a positive value, but I just want to know on the basis of either a negative or a positive, not both, then I can say that this condition cannot be sufficient enough. So I can directly drop down to -3, -2, and -1, which has all the negative values. So when I ask myself, is x greater than 0? I'll say no, x is not greater than 0. It's been like, you know, 8+ years I've been dealing and, you know, talking about GMAT, tutoring students across the globe. You know, this is a very basic questions I can question right now, which we have taken. I understand there's nothing much applied here. But one thing that I point out here is, why do we actually struggle at times with DS? What is it that makes us struggle? Is those the concept? No, that is not the concept. Are those the approaches? Yes, maybe approaches. Actually, what happens in the GMAT, which I've recently experienced talking to a lot of students across the globe who have recently either taken their GMAT official test or maybe, you know, they have taken the official test or maybe the mock practice, which they do. It's been very much common. And one point that I have come across is, everyone is looking for a particular set of condition that is an answer or that could be an answer. And then we start solving for it to prove whether it is an answer or not. Today's approaches would give you an upper edge wherein you would know the answer and then you just have to solve to make sure it is an answer. See, I'm re-repeating myself. the first conventional way is to find which could be the answer and then try solving to know is it an answer or not. So now you have got five different options to see A, B, C, D, E to which is the answer. Today's approaches are mainly focused upon what is exactly the answer, what could be likely the answer, and my solution starts in the same direction. I save my time there. So if reading a question, if I could get to know that this is C, I don't say that 100% that would be C. There could be trap, there could be key questions attached to it. But if that is C, I'll not waste my time checking A or B. I'll directly jump on C, taking both the conditions, matching it with up. If it works, fine. Otherwise, my answer happens to be E. Next question, that is it. So this saves my time and this gives me a much, much confidence. Now, if I bring in the, I've already solved this question, but again, like if you bring in the solution to you in front, it's again a common mistake type one, which says common mistake type one is CMT1. Yes, both yes and no from the same condition. So it will be not sufficient. Condition one says X is equals to -1. So see, it's giving me two answers here. One is no, another is yes. Definitely, this is not the condition that is sufficient. Over here, if I talk about for every single value, I'm getting a common answer, which is no, no, and no. So yes, this could be a satisfied conditions for me, but was there any catch into it? Did they mention it's an integer? No. Did they mention anything about it? No. Is it a statistics or something? No. So we are readily going ahead with the fact that, you know, we have made sure that it's not a key question. So I can directly mark a fact that, you know, my answer would be a unique B. And my, you know, the condition one here will not give me any sufficiency to the answer the question. And hence my answer would be B for it. So I mean, I repeat, it's an easy question to, you know, take care of. But again, I just wanted to show you the application of CMT1. And therein where we have taken the, you know, easy question. Now let's talk about the another set of questions that we have in front right now. It should be there on your screen soon. Okay, it's there. It says if hash is one of the operations, and which is addition, multiplication, or division, is 8 symbol of hash 2 is equals to 10. See, question is still open-ended is, but pay attention to this. What can be the operation between 8 and 2 to make it as 10? And the operation available for you are only this 3. So will that be a multiplication or a division or addition? So this is very basic. I mean, it would be an addition because 8 added to 2 or 2 added to 8 will always give me 10. So now understand, my question is not about 8 and 2 and 10. My question is this particular hash an addition? That's it. So this is, you know, when you spend time on the original question, when you try modifying it, you are way ahead of answering it so quickly looking at the option. I'll be talking about this approach in the detail in the later part of today's session, that where we should stop on the question, modify the original question to such an extent therein where we could directly land up to the answer. Now over here, if you see, it's very basic. I mean, it's a common mistake type one question because it is, so my answer would be yes or a unique no, but not both. And if I start now the basic fundamental of this particular question, I said a word called modifying. So this is wherein my first step was that you modify and recheck the original condition first. Jumping onto a situation or a condition to solve is not always a possible or a perfect approach. Spend time on a question if you seek an opportunity to, you know, to modify it, it will be a great effort put by you and your answers would be accurate. So now if you talk about this particular question, as I've already told, this hash is an addition. Now I'll bring the variable approach, which I have already discussed in my last session, but for the new audiences, the variable approach always talks about matching up the variables involved in the original questions with the conditions and how many equations do I need. In short, I could say that suppose if there are two variables, X and Y, definitely I require two equations to solve those. So over here, what I see is there is just one variable that is hash. And why is it a variable? Just because it can have three possible options, which are addition, multiplication, or division. Hence, it is a variable. So if it is a one variable, definitely out of this particular conditions, I'll get one equation each. When I say one equation each, I just need one equation to solve this, and I'm getting each one equation from both. So my possible answer should be D. Now see, now I know the answer. I just have to see whether it is D or not. I'm not finding which could be the answer. I already know it should be D. I'm just checking it out. And when I know that this has to be a D, then my first step would be checking A, checking B, and then I'll be going across. If A and B works together fine with me, definitely it would be a D. So in this particular set, if I see, the first situation over here is 6 hash 2, that is equals to 3. What makes 6 and 2 equals to 3? Definitely a division. But my question is on the 8 and 2? No, my question is about hash. So now see, this is wherein, you know, the modification over here has helped us. Because what happens is, we pay major attention to 8, 2, and 10. We don't think about this particular hash. And the secondly, now we try relating this 6, 2, and 3 to 8, 2, and 10. But the concern is, are they talking about the numbers here? No. They're talking about this particular variable. So my focus is more on the variable. What makes 6 and 2 equals to 3 out of this particular operation? It would be division. So my question was, is hash an addition? No, it is not. So my particular first equation is done. It is sufficient enough to answer my question. So if it is A, it cannot be E. So my answer choice is now is still, and it cannot be C also, because I don't have to combine this. So either it end up as A or D. D is pretty clear. Hash is division. So is hash addition? No. So now see, this is wherein, you know, I was talking at the start, when you know the answer, it's just you have to check up around it rather than finding what could be the answer. And you know, you may take time, but again, you'll not much take time if your concepts are intact about this to master this particular approach. And you know, most of the students have been following same approaches in their real GMAT, in their practice mocks, to get the answer thoroughly, and they are able to make cool Q49, 50, 48, and that is consistent. So they're gaining much of the confidence on this. And yeah, that is it. Let's move ahead with the CMT1 and CMT2 more. So unique answers are sufficient. Now, majorly we'll be talking about CMT2 here, wherein it says that the unique answers is something that we have to look upon, and that has to be sufficient enough. So in this particular scenario, we know that there has to be only one answer. So when I say there has to be only one answer, the question would definitely give me a variable and will ask for its value. Simple. So right now, this question asks me R is equals to what? There's no word, open-ended word called is and whether. No. So it is only looking for a particular value, nothing else than this. Now, see, how many variables do I have in short? One. And what would be the answer? But again, the concern over here is, I'll just go ahead with the CMT2. R cube minus R square minus 6R is equals to 0. R has a highest power of 3. Possibly, I'll end up getting how many values? 3. This is a cubical polynomial, so we can definitely understand that there would be 3 values to it. Will those 3 values be different or same? So again, that is wherein, you know, if we just factorize and FOIL method, we get to know that R is equals to 0, 3, or minus 2. This is a basic set, and I'm pretty sure that you guys can handle it very easily. So, but condition 2 says that R is equals to minus 2R. Now, see, this R is actually related to this R here. It's not a powered one. So if R is equals to minus 2 times of R, definitely what you could do is you can bring in 2R on the other side, and that happens to be 3R. So that gives me a value of R equals to 0. So now see, R was 0 here as well. R is 0 here as well. But over here, you still have two more more numbers or values that can actually put this particular equation as to be 0. So in this sort of question, the only thing basic that we will be talking is stick to a uniqueness of the answer. The more you are sticking to the uniqueness of the answer, the more possible cases you draw out, it won't be a trouble for you. Now, this is something that, you know, we have been talking about the CMTs and CMT1, we have talked about CMT2, we have talked about. And now I would definitely want that, you know, once we move ahead with the session, once we talk about the more approaches here, you start solving the questions. And if you could put your answers before looking into the solutions and discussing it over the chat window. So, okay, fine. I have a question for all of you here. It should be there on the screen in a minute. It says the square root of 2 is less than m, which is less than the square root of 22. You need to find the value of m. And it says m is an integer. That is your first condition. And second is m is the square of an integer. See, first of all, the first thing first, which I want to know, what am I dealing here with? That is m. The only thing that I'm dealing here is only one variable, that is m. But it is a one variable. The only thing that I need is one equation. If I require one equation, I can get it from these two conditions. So my possible answer, or the most likely answer, should be D. Now, if I know that this is D, then I have to start my solution checking A and B. So I cannot directly jump where? I cannot jump drawing C and E. Because in later part of the session, we'll be directly jumping to C and E as well. So this is wherein, you know, I've been more focusing and, you know, paying attention to stress on this word. So this is a common mistake question again. I mean, like, it's asking for M equals to what? So I need a unique answer for this. Now, square root of 2 is less than M, is less than 22. So in this particular question, how about let's talk about, again, I'm re-repeating, please modify it, right? It looks easy, but please modify it. So the square root of 2 is 1.4, the square root of 22. Now see, the square root of 16 is 4 and square root of 25 is 5. So my values lie somewhere between 4 and 5. So which is like 4 point something, which is marked as 4.x6 here. So I know that my value of m should lie somewhere between 1.4 to 4.x6. And it is not inclusive because I've just got a less than sign here. So it's an open-ended inequality. So now when I know that there should be the answer D for this, I'll strictly go directly to the step A to solve this particular question. And then let's see where do we end up with. But I'll tell you the catch in this once we solve this. Now when the first thing says M is an integer, so it could have any values between it. M is an integer pertaining to only the question. It can have the values like 2, it can be 3, it can be 4. I'm just looking out for the values between 1.4 to 4 point something. So the values possible to me is 2, 3, 4. I can seriously make out that this is not unique. But when it says M is the square of an integer, I just know one thing. The value which is a square of an integer such that it should lie between 1.4 and 4.4 or 4.xx is only 4. That is it. Because if I go with 3, that is 9. Squaring 3, I will get 9. That will be out of range. square of 1 is 1, that is again out of range because my range is starting from 1.4, and 2 is square is 4, so that is the again only number that I could get through. So my B would give me a value, a single value, which is 4. So in this scenario, what happens is the condition 2 alone is sufficient. Now, I'll come back to this particular trick again back once we once we go ahead with the session. But just start thinking about the fact, I said D is the likely answer. That means A and B alone should have been sufficient. Then what happens in this that makes only B as an answer? So we are actually started our journey for traps. So this is, you know, wherein we need to be very much aware about. And this all is something that our CMT4B would be talking more about, which we have in the later part of the session. Now, how do we distinguish between CMT1 and CMT2? So see, common mistake type 1 is all about an open-ended question therein where it asks about yes or no. Common mistake type 2 is all about the questions therein where it asks about the unique value. So in this set of questions, we see is x equals to 0? Is x equals to 0? Common mistake type 1 question. So is x equals to 0 over here? No. But is x equals to 0 over here? No. Again, a single variable. I have two equations. My answer would be D. That's it. So now see, how much time do I have saved once I have a confidence in this particular approach? Detail of this approach is pretty well organized and available on the website. You can sign up, go into the lessons, C, D, and E. You can go through these approaches. I'm not pushing you to learn these approaches for the topics which you're already good at, but definitely you can look upon these approaches to at least solve the questions or, you know, to take care of those particular topic which you feel is still required some improvement. So even if you could learn this only for, say, 3 topics out of 10 which you require, those 3 topics would be your strength after 7 days of practice. Plus, you already have your another 7 topics ready with you. So in short, you're already good with 10 topics and you have a lot of approaches. And with these 3 topics which you apply, once you start getting the answer, you will build in confidence in these approaches. As I'm again repeating it, it's not that easy to master it overnight because it has taken good amount of, you know, year or months maybe to develop this. So if it has taken so much of time, definitely there would be some trap to it that has to be come through. So I'll just say go through it, make a note of proper, challenge yourself. Don't jump onto the start solving. Challenge yourself that I'll solve the question through variable approach. Challenge yourself that I'll look forward for common mistake type 1, common mistake type 2. And therein where you would trespassing the conventional approach which you may have been following to get through the answers every time. So again, this particular question that we have been looking upon, it simply says that the condition alone is sufficient. I believe there would be some people over here who may see that, you know, the solution is taking 2 slides. I mean, those are long solution indeed. Okay, so, you know, see, don't worry about this. You don't have to end up writing this statements every time in the GMAT. This is more or less an organized form of these approaches in the terms of PPTs and the presentations and the videos on the website. So we need to make sure when we develop it for the students, they have everything well written, well framed and consolidated so that they understand and relate it. So when they want to go back to the questions in the previous slide, they can. When they want to move to the next situations, they can. So this is why it may look right now that, you know, it will take more time for me because I have to write so many things. No, you don't have to end up writing so many things. This particular cases when we talk about is the detailing of that particular step that we are taking. When you just map up your particular question, let me tell you, it's just 6 steps at max that can let you to the DS answer. In the worst case scenario, therein where you will be talking about 47 to 51 level questions. And what happens is if you are still struggling to find which can be the answer, you would not have upper hand on considering all the possible cases. And this is the major problem which happens in the DS. In a particular question, I may consider two cases only and I mark my answer, but there was a hidden case which I didn't pay attention to. Why did I didn't pay attention to? I'm not taking my test casually, no. I've been preparing extensively for this particular test over the months or maybe a year. I've dropped my job. I'm working and paying attention to my GMAT. There are a lot of attributes that, you know, there are a lot of hard work that you guys are already putting it into. But again, what is it that, you know, why am I not able to consider those three cases? Why always I end up considering two cases and I mark my answer as C maybe, but the answer was E. So, you know, this is wherein, you know, we have felt that we should design something which can at least give you a direction to solve a question. Solving is must because we're dealing with math. But let me tell you, my friends, this is one of the strong weapon that I have got to, you know, demystify my GMAT. And every time I've taken my mock, you know, scoring perfect or maybe a less than Q, it's working for me. And if it can work for me, let me tell you, it will work for you. The only thing is you have to just devote some time to it. You have to be serious about it, practice it, and that is it. Okay, let's move on to the next question set quickly. And let's move on to the next, you know, pages maybe. Therein where it will be talking about CMT2, CMT1. And we have to quickly look to CMT3, some statistics questions. But this is a very basic question that I could see right now. X is what? X is what? CMT2. Reason? X is what? So a unique value. X is minus 1. X is minus 1 and 1. So now again, see, there is a trap. One variable I'm talking about, that, but again, the answer happens to be only one. That is a condition alone. So see, this is something the trap is. Now, see, concern is over here, they're asking us what is X, and they're giving us a conditions in such a way that, you know, anyone can make up or made up the fact that what could be the answer. It doesn't require a brilliant mind or, you know, a programmed mind for the GMAT to find the answer for this question. Even a high school student can tell me the solution for this. But again, the concern is, which I'm just showing you the applications of it, and that is wherein this question has been picked. But think about the case wherein they give you the statements, and this is something which you have to consider or bring in as a case or a possible cases on your own. So this is wherein, you know, the challenge occurs. This is wherein a student struggles. They might not consider minus one. They might not consider one. They just take minus one as an answer, then mark D as an answer. So this is wherein, you know, we have to talk about the particular cases, and you can definitely go ahead with this particular approaches. And let's go with something which I like the most, which is common mistake type 4A. And this is something is all about the key questions. Now, this is wherein the most trickiest question, the hard level questions we will be talking about. And I'll give you time to solve this, if you could relate it to the concept, and let's see if we could get to the answers quickly onto this. But before that, if you start, let's understand what a common mistake type 4A is. Just looking at the question, so when you will actually master the concept of a variable approach, which is variable approach is just matching how many variables a question has. Does that question has only the variable, or does it has an equation also with it? Because there are possibility of an equation, like in a speed distance time question, there are three variables involved and there is always one equations involved. So there could be possibility. Number of total chairs and tables sold in a particular art gallery was 30. So there are two variables involved, table and chair, and there is one value involved. So that is 30. So, you know, you're getting number of variables, you're getting number of equations. And now you've been trying to know that whether am I getting enough number of equations to solve those questions directly from the conditions. If that happens to be the case, then therein where I say that either my D would be an answer or either C would be an answer and everything. So this approach here, what says that if you're getting an answer C too easily, you need to consider A or B as an answer. Now, this is the real trap. Just looking at the question, if you feel like, oh, wow, C is the answer. No one can stop me to mark this. Hold your horses. Let me tell you, it's a catch question. It's a key question. And definitely, if you make a mistake of directly jumping on C, you will definitely combine and you'll get the answer. But you will not get it right because the answer was A and B. So this is the beauty of, you know, see, this is what I said. If it is dealing with integers, statistics, probability, inequality, and absolute value, please, please be more focused with this. So if we go ahead with this in the later part, A or B is more likely answer than C. This is what we can say about it. A or B is more likely answer than C. And now see, if both A and C appears to be an answer in this particular case, this is what a jot down for you can be, which you can already make out. And you can definitely make a note of it into your, you know, on the notebooks or a paper you're marking your notes for. If A and C both appears to be an answer, and if you have an ingot filling of either of it, mark A as an answer. Only if they are integers, statistics, probability, inequalities, or absolute value questions. If the similar situation occurs when it is B or C, and B and C, your answer would be B. Now, how to go ahead with it is something that, you know, we need to look to the question definitely. And once that is flashed on your screen, I'll just take in consideration the variable approach. I'll leave the solution to the variable approach. And now I want my audience to please solve that particular question for me, applying the approaches that we are learning right now, or we are trying to learn right now. So I now need my audience to be more active. As we were in the last session, we were a lot of active and, you know, everyone almost had a right answers. So now this is wherein, you know, because we are dealing with CMT4A, key questions, more traps. So this is wherein, you know, let's solve this. X and Y are integers. I don't want you to focus upon solution right now. Just pay attention to the fact X and Y are integer. It is an integer question. First thing, my mind says it's a key question. There can be a trap. Second, how many variables, X and Y? They ask me, will X, Y, that means a product of X, Y, will be an even number. Okay, fine. I am not jumping onto the possible solutions. When two things will give me an even number, odd, even, odd. I'm not thinking anything right now. I'm just focusing on certain words. It's an integer question. All right. It's X, Y. There are two variables. For two variables, I need two equations. Do I have an equation here right now? No. From where will I get my equation? From the first condition, I'll get one equation to solve. From second condition, I'll get one equation to solve. When I say equation, that means either a word, either the value, either the number. So from here, if I'm getting two, and if I need a two, that means I'm combining both to get what am I doing is I'm combining both to get two equations. That means my answer should be C. But it's an integer question. So my answer should be either A or B. Now, this is an approach that is not only limited to this sort of questions. It is applicable in almost every sort of questions when it is a high standard or high level question. So X, Y is even. This is something which we have already done through, which is there right now. So, see, this is why CMT4A comes into picture. You're getting easily C, right, over here. So consider A or B as an answer. So now I have to check this equation separately. I'll set it across. XY is an even number. So what could be the possibility? XY is an even number. Wherein it says X is even. Why is an odd? When C is the answer, did I check A or B? No, I haven't. Why? I'll tell you later. Why did I not check A or B? Because I just want to show you how the trap happens. Two variables, two equations, C is the answer. I jump on combining both. X is even, suppose 2. Y is odd, suppose 3. 3 times 2, 6. That is even. Even number multiplied with an odd number, it's a basic fundamental that it will always give me an even number. Question is XY an even number? Question is answer would be a unique yes or no. That means CMT, that is a common mistake type 1, which we have learned at the start, is also applied here indirectly or directly. So my answer has to be unique, no or yes. So is XY an even number combining both? Yes, of course it's an even number. Answer is C. I'm happy marking it. I can never ever get to know this fact whether I'm marking it correct or not. Because did I pay attention to the integers? If yes, then why did I mark C? Why didn't I just consider this A or B as a separate equation once and tried out solving this question? When I know that I've learned my common mistake types, I've learned this, that if there happens to be an integer question and if it feels like C is a very simple answer, then I have to check A and B no matter what. Because when you practice such sort of combinations, that product of two numbers can be even, product of two numbers can be odd, you always have that in your mind. While reading this question, X, Y is an even number, your mind would start giving you possible cases. Okay, wait, X, Y is an even number. It is only possible when both are even. It is only possible when one is even, one is odd. Okay, fine. So you're checking the same. Now what you do is you go on to the options. You say X is an even, Y is an odd. Oh, wow. It is even, right? So now you say that X is an even number, Y is an odd number. You got both. And therein where you end up marking the answers. So now if we see X is an even number, okay? If X is even, does it really matter what a Y is? Because if Y is even, my answer would be even. 2 times 4, 8. But if my Y is odd, again, my answer would be even. So do you feel that this condition was sufficient enough not to get combined with second to answer this question now? If you feel yes, there was no need of combining it, definitely you can mark your answer as yes, there was no need of combining it on the chat window. I'm still looking for the responses of audience. But see, this is wherein, you know, we fail. We jump onto the solution. Because a mind is mapped with this fact. Product of two number has to be even. Okay, even times even, that is one. Even times odd, that is another. What I have to see? I have to just see these two conditions. What is this? Even. This is odd. Done. My work is done. See, combine. I'm not even paying attention to the fact that it's an integer question. So CMT1, common mistake type 1 and 2, that is okay because you guys have practiced so much that you understand the unique answer yes, unique answer no, and this all works. But this is one thing I'll definitely recommend and request that you have a proper attention to this kind of approaches. Let's go on the Y is an odd number. If this Y happens to be an odd, what about X? Do I have enough information on X? What if this X changes from even to odd? Will that make a change to my answer? Of course, because if X is even and Y is still an odd, I'll get even. But if odd and odd times odd, 3 times 5 will be 15. So I'm getting two answers, yes or no. So my condition one alone is sufficient. And this is more than enough to support the concept wherein it says that if it happens to appear C as an answer, stop yourself and try checking A and B, please, for this. This can also happen. I'm telling it to you right now. We are dealing with such an example therein where it is pretty visible. Think about the questions where they have statements. And then you have to think about the cases first. And then you get through the solution. In that, this approach works very quickly. Let's go with this question quickly. How many variables do I have here before reading that if? So there is a condition attached to it. If A and B, that is two, there is something two. What are those integers? Okay, key question. If it is C, please A and B. I'm already set to check it as A and B. I'll not combine this. Is negative of 3 raised to the power of 2 times of A plus B less than 0? A is an even number, B is an odd number. Consideration point is very simple. A and B are integers. I need two equations. If I need two equations, I'll get it from here. If I get it from here, as simple as the answer is C, but an integer question, it can be A or it can be B. First thing first I have to do is I have to check A and B separately to make sure that C is not the answer. Secondly, never get confused. This is not an equation that is given. This is a part of a question because there's a word attached to is. So now if we go ahead with this, we already know this, whatever has been there on the slide right now, that they're dealing with two integers, possible answers could be C, but if the integer questions, there could be a trap in this, and then I have to actually go easy on this to make sure that, I take the conditions separately and I mark out. And it's very simple. See, if A is an even number, 2 times of A would be always even. B is an odd number, even plus odd would always give me an odd. If you raise a negative power to an odd number, it will always be a negative, which is less than 0. My answer is yes. Do I still require a pen and a paper to solve this question? No. But again, I'm making a mistake. Why am I combining this two when I know it's integer questions? So in this particular scenario, what happens is, if we go ahead with this common mistake type 1, if we recall a common mistake type 4a, wherein it says, if it happens to be an integer question, we need to check A and B. We'll separately check it. And now it is related to more or less a question that we have done just previously. If I check A as an even number, 2 times A would always be an even, because if you multiply 2 to any number, it would be an even. And even plus B. So now if B is even, even plus even will give me even. So answer to this question, minus 3 to the power of negative 3 to the power of any even number would definitely be a positive number. So is that less than 0? No. So my answer is no here. For B equals to even. But for B equals to odd, this particular question, even plus odd, will give me an odd. And this happens to be yes. So now, see, I have yes, I have no. And in this scenario, the concern is very simple, that B equals to even, and this is even and odd, I'm getting 2 no and yes, not done. I require unique values. But we were marking C, right? We were combining and we were marking C. Okay, fine. We still have B to check. B is an odd number. It's proved it is odd. Whatever A, B, 2 times A would be 3. Or 2 times A would be 6. 2 times A, whatever it is, be it odd, be it even. 2 times A would be always an even. Even plus odd would always give me an odd. A negative value raised to the power of an odd would always be less than 0 because it's a negative. My answer is done. I'm done with this. Let me tell you guys, right now it seems to be long, but again, when you try doing it, this is the space of your page. you'll be able to solve this question, or it could be even lesser. And you guys are already brilliant applying the concept so quick. So in that scenario, what happens is, you know, the space is less, time utilization is less, and GMAT is done. Let's go ahead with the another concept of queue and another concept of CMT. Now we'll be dealing with the common mistake type of 4B. 4A was, if you're getting answer as C, quickly please hold. Make sure that you may have to end up checking A and B if those are questions related to statistics, probability, inequalities, absolute values, or integers. Now we'll be talking about a common mistake type B. Just looking at the condition, either a one or a two, when you master variable approach, you get very quickly that what could be my answer depending upon how many variables and conditions or equations are there. When you see that my answer could be A or B, don't jump. Mark your answer D. Consider D to be an answer. Now see, this is something, suppose you've just been left with maybe less than 2 or 3 minutes of your exam. This works absolutely fantastic in those particular time set also. But why do I have to take my test to a level therein where I've been just left out with 3 minutes? Why can't I just start applying these approaches right away from the start so that I have plentiful amount of time at the end of the test? Or before, I may end up the test at least 10 minutes before with accuracy of maybe Q47 plus. So this is wherein you have to think that, you know, at what level I'll apply this particular question. Now see, this is a very beautiful, and it is one of the approaches that is very close to my heart. Why is that? I mean, it just talk about almost same what we have learned into common mistake type 4A. It's again deals with the same sort of questions which are dealing with integers, statistics, probability, inequality, and absolute value. And but the only condition it says is like, you know, if you are considering either A or B to an answer easily, then please go with D as an answer. So what happens is like, you know, this is one of the line that you need to make sure that you work upon. It says if one condition is easy, the other condition is hard to solve, to find the values, maybe answer it as D. Okay. Now let's go with the question. So I'll give you 3 minutes, apply the variable approach and try proving whether this approach is applicable to this question or not. And I'm actually looking for the solution on this. Apply the same approaches which says, you know, how many variables are there? First, find out how many variables are there, how many equations would be required, how many equations would be required, and then get to know the fact that what could be my answer. Are you getting easily A as an answer and B as an answer? And then try checking D as an answer. So just get a confidence approach to it. Meanwhile, I'll just grab a cup of water for myself, and I'll just connect you back in 2 minutes. Meanwhile, the question is there on the screen right now. Just apply the variable approach and feel the beauty of this. Just give me a moment and I'll just get back with the water, and then we'll continue with the other approaches at the same. Okay. And I'll appreciate if you could just forward the answers, because this slide just has a start of it. Answer is not yet there. But again, I want you to actually bring in that confidence that when I said A or B can easily be an answer, why it could be D. So just go through it for once. I'll be back in 1 minute. All right, guys, I'm back. Sorry for the interruption. All right, so what does it say? Is A and B are positive integers? Okay. So there are two variables, A and B, and they are positive integers. Okay. So they're integers any which way. So it's an integer question and they're positive. So fine. What is the value of A over B? I need to find the value of this particular ratio, which is A over B. Okay. See, B looks so simple to me, and I can definitely answer. I mean, like, it's not me. Like, you know, every one of us can answer that A over B would be 2 over 3 in the simplified way, or 4 over 6. So in that particular scenario, what happens is, like, this particular case is getting me an answer very easy. So I'll end up marking my answer as B there. This is a catch. This is a trap. This is why they gave it to us. They don't want us to think on the rocket science or any level beyond the imagination. This is wherein, you know, a particular, even the expert student would get trapped. So the concern here is it's a positive. Positive is okay. That's a one restriction. But integers is something which is very open key. So in this particular question, if I have to go through this, it simply says to me one thing, that if B seems to be an answer, then I'll go with checking A and B. And if one condition is easy, one condition is hard, that is okay. Condition one and condition two together. Now, where does the C comes from? Because that's a variable approach, right? If you have two integers, you require two equations. And if you require two equations to solve this question, then this two equation would come from these conditions. And therein where you can definitely get through that C could be an answer. So I have just combined it. So if 4A plus 7B is equal to 29, which is 6, and 6A is equal to 4B, definitely dividing both the sides by 2, I get 3a equals to 2b. So a happens to be 2 times of b, 3. So what am I getting here is the value of a in terms of b. If I substitute this value particularly in a, in the first equation, after a couple of rearrangements and simplification that we'll go through, we'll get the exact value of a equals to 2. And definitely, if I get A equals to 2, then B would also have a value to it. And then we'll be able to get B equals to 3. But it says the sufficient answer is C because we have combined it. Now, see, there are two things which I'll make a note of here. Please pay attention to this. First, when I apply a variable approach to this particular question, it says there are two variables, A and B. So there should be two equations at least to solve this question. These two equations would definitely come from the condition one and condition two. Possibly looking, answer should be C. Okay, fine. It's an integer question. That says that if C looks to be an equation or C looks to be an answer, please check A or B. Okay, fine. And if something looks very easy to you, mark B as an answer. People try relating what I'm trying to say. CMT4A going over to CMT4B. So this is what I said. I mean, like, you'll take time to master it. So I may not check this condition in my real exam. Let me tell you this. This is just to show you what is happening and why we'll not consider this answer C, because it's an integer and therein where we have to apply the steps for A and B to make sure their answers, or we have to make sure that, you know, D could be the answer. So this is why this portion was taken care of. I'm sorry if someone is confused with this, but again, I'm re-repeating, you don't have to go through this. This is just has been shown to tell you that C is the answer, could be the probable answer, if we would not have paid attention to the word called integers. Because if C would not have been answered, then you would have jumped on A, B, checking those, and there would have been a lot of tantrums to market. And definitely no one checks for after C. If C is not the answer, then they mark E. So concern is the same. This portion is not required for you to solve in the real time exam. So you know that C, okay, fine, but it is an integer, A and B. So I have to start my solution checking A or B first. And if I start checking my solution for A or B first, take an easy particular equation. Why? Simple. When it is C, the approach says the answer should be A or B. Fine. Second approach, if either of the condition which is given in A or B is easy, and when we say easy, that means it's too much direct. You don't hardly require maths to do it. Then mark answer is D. So I'll not combine this equation. Rather, I'll jump on C, A and B as a separate equation or a condition, out of which I could see second condition is so simple. 6A equals to 4B. This is something which I even told you at the start of the question. So A over B happens to be 2 over 3. Now, will I stop myself marking it as B as an answer, or will I still check A? I will check A. I'll not answer B. I'll check A. So see, this is what the concern is. You need to check A and B. This is what you know in this question when you read it. This is what you get out of variable approach. You're not trying to fix or get to know which could be the answer. The solution that we're doing right now, to just to know which is the answer. That's it. Because you know this is the answer. And this is wherein, you know, if you know it in DS, you're half of the, you know, stress is out. When we try this 4a plus 7b equals to 29, I pretty take this fact into consideration that my audience understand what is a relative prime concept. So relative primes, two numbers are relative primes with each other if they have a common factor. And that is only one common factor, which is 1. 4 and 7 is the relative prime here. So this A and B would only have one pair. That can suffice, or that can be substituted such that the addition of 4 times of A plus 7 times of B should give me 29. By hit and trial, I can understand 4 times A, that is, so 4 times 2, if I take A equals to 2, that happens to be 8. I'm just short of 21 more. 7 times 3 is 21, so 2 comma 3 is the pair that I can get it through. What is the value here? 2 over 3. What is the value here? 2 over 3. Why did I circle this? Just because I want you to just pay attention to one more thing which is about to come in our presentation, which is, if condition 1 and condition 2 gives me the same value, my answer is D. Let me tell you, I can give you so many approaches and a shortcut to solve so that DS is no longer a stress and you have a enough amount of time to consider all the possible cases. These are designed just to save time so that you can consider all the possible cases, and when you mark your answer, you're sure that, you know, yes, I haven't left any single case therein where the answer may change. And it's very basic to understand that. It's just about, you know, you go through our lessons, sit back with your notebook, make a note of it. There are a lot of questions that are given. And there are a lot of questions that are given, and therein where, you know, you could actually see the applications of those. And this is how, you know, you can absolutely check out that what is the concern, or I mean, like, what is the Chayan has asked one of the questions that I missed it. He says, sir, why only condition two alone is sufficient is not the answer. Okay. Chayan, see, when you see this particular question, it says 6A is equals to 4B, right? And therein where you see it that, you know, it's only, this is what you need to find. If you could get A and B, you can definitely find not only A over B, you can find A times B, B over A, whatever operations you want to put through. So that is pretty okay. But the concern is, why didn't you check condition A? What made you not check condition A? Just because B is looking as what you need in the answer, is that the case? No. When I see that 4 and 7 are the relative primes, there could be only one pair of A and B that will suffice me the what condition, right? And this is the property of the relative primes. So once you have a control and, you know, your logic's clear on the relative prime, you will have a lot of such questions, and to the same extent, therein where this question particularly will not be an issue for you. So in this scenario, this is what we need to, understand. And let's say, so what should be the answer indeed then? D. And this is wherein. Okay, let's talk about the another question. The question says, if X, Y, and Z are positive integer, people, there are three variables now. And X, Y is equals to Z. There is one equation. So this is what I was actually talking about, I guess, 15 minutes ago. That it's not only the variable. It's also about certain equations that we also deal about. So three variables you have. One equation you already have. You need two more equations to need. You can get those two equations from the two conditions. Answer should be C. It's an integer question. I'll hold my thoughts. I'll check A and B. Also in that, I'll check both A and B. I'll not fall for anything that is simple or anything that is seems easy to me and just mark my answer. Because I also know that if A and B, either of them is looking easy to me, D could be the answer. So see, final reach is D. Somewhere in the middle, if I could get something not sufficient for, I'll stop myself. But I know where do I have to go to prove it. This is what I have been talking so far. You know where you have to go, what you have to actually find. You're not checking whether D is an answer. You're just seeing, is D answer, you know, how long it would take for me to see the D is an answer. So am I going in a channel or not? C is definitely an answer for this question. Why? Because the concern is very simple. Z is equals to 1 if I put it here, and X equals to Z is here. Definitely I'll get the answer is Y. So I'll get the answer is C just without a pen and a paper. Krishnan has already given us an answer right now. Why he has given me an answer is D. Why not C? When I have three variables, I have one equation, so I can solve those two equations. Sumit has also come up with D. So now see, this is wherein the concern is. C could be an answer, but this is an integer question. My answer would be A or B. If it's A or B is an answer, I have to check both to make sure that it's D as an answer. If either of this fails to sufficient, my answer is still here. I'm not wasting my time. I'm not at all wasting my time checking this. But if I fail to check either of this, then I'll be trapped. And this is wherein, you know, variable approach is one. It gives you a which gives you a highlight of what are the chances of any option to be an answer, plus common mistake types 4A and 4B is something that gonna definitely save us from marking any wrong answers to it. So D would be an answer for this particular question, yes, because when you say Z is equals to 1, then definitely if Z is equals to 1 over here, then you can definitely made up the solution, and then XY is equals to 1. Product of two numbers is equals to positive 1 is only possible when X is 1 and Y is 1. You cannot take X equals to 1 over 2 and Y equals to 2 because they have strictly said, first thing first, it is an integer. Secondly, it's a positive. So even A is answering, and A is very simple, and B looks very simple to me. So do we need to check for the term contain integer? Yes. Yes, Sumit. So, you know, do you know, like, how do I approach to this sort of questions? I always see this particular terms. I'll just repeat those. Integers. Statistics is something, you know, they'll not say statistics. This is a statistics question. We are not into, you know, the curriculum. So statistics is easily understood. Inequality can easily be seen with the, you know, inequality sign. Absolute value can easily be seen from 5 meters distance also with such kind of mod. Probability is like, you know, what are the chances they talk about. But when it comes to integers, let me tell you one thing. Positive integers and non-negative integers again make difference. Non-negative integers, even I'll consider zero. Positive integers, I'll not consider zero. So every single word that comes into a question plays an important role. Okay, so and see, these are the levels there in, you know, the question seems to be very easy, but again, the concern is we are more talking about the application of the common mistake types. This is why, you know, it seems to you that this is so easy question that why do we need to apply it? But once we proceed ahead, we will know that what level of difficulty we will have and how this particular approaches will save us. And then again, what you could do best is just go ahead with this, the lesson plans, and then you can definitely see a lot of other practice questions and 700 plus level questions and start application on this. So once you gain a confidence over this approaches with the basic question, therein where you will have enough confidence applying this to the hard level questions. Now I'll go very quickly with this because this is basic CM, common mistake type 3 and 4. Right now, what we did was only common mistake type 4 of A and 4 of B, which says if C is the answer, stop yourself, check A and B. And if either of that seems to be very easy, don't jump to mark answer. Just go ahead and check out for D. Yes, Chen, the answer was each condition alone is sufficient in the previous question. Over here, if your integers, statistics, probability, inequality, and absolute value, if they have at least two variables, now see, we are dealing with two variables, two or more than two, your most likely answer happens to be C. Now, this is one of the conditions that I'll be talking about for next 5 minutes, and we'll quickly wrap through certain questions on this, which says condition one and condition two are independent. So what makes it condition one and condition two are independent? The question that would be there on your, on the screen right now will actually talk about it and we'll go through it. It says A and B are positive integers. Again, the first thing first, A and B, two variables. I would definitely require two equations to solve the question. My answer should be C. Just reading this first four words, if A and B, I can make out that where do I have to go through. Are positive integers. Positive, I keep it on the paper right now because I have just have to consider the values which are positive. It is integers question. C cannot be the answer. Reason, it's an integer question. I have learned if C cannot be the answer, if it's an integer question, I have to check A and B. My answer changes. What is the value of B? Fine. value of B, that will be a unique value. That means CMT2 is again applied into it. That's a common mistake type 2. So condition 1 and condition 2 are independent. What do we know? Say, now this is a very basic fundamental of any sort of data sufficiency. When you check A, it's only A condition. Or when you check condition 1, there's nothing called condition 2 involved here. If you're checking condition 2, there's nothing called condition 1 involved here. I'm telling it to you very upfront. This has happened with a lot of the students. While solving, they'll put this value of A equals to 2 also, just considering condition number 1. Indirectly, what they're doing is they combine both. They mark C. And therein where they get trapped. So in this particular situation, one condition, one time, that is it. Second condition, second time. But yes, the best thing which you could think about is what? The best thing that you could think about is which option do you have to pick first to solve? You may end up taking first option, first condition to solve first, second. And there are a lot of lessons that we have catered on the website which says in what sort of situation you should think about considering the second condition first to solve, not the first. If it is involving a ratio, if it is involving inequality, then what should we better do in conditions to which condition should be taken first in order to get to the answer. Now let's go with this. If A and B are positive integers, what is the value of B? Do you feel that, okay, fine, let's go with condition number 2 first because it seems to be very easy. A equals to 2. If A is equals to 2, 2 over 2 times 2 would be, this will be 4. But why am I keeping this value here? See, this is wherein, students make mistakes. A equals to 2. What is B? A is equals to 2. What is value of B? So new California has experienced severe snowfall. What is the temperature in Adelaide right now? How am I relating these two things? A is equal to 2. What is the value of B? Who can answer this particular question in this world? So this doesn't look sufficient to me. Where is B? If I go on this, 2 to the power of A is equal to 7 to the power of B is equal to 1372. When you get such sort of numbers, the bigger numbers, best thing best, just prime factorize. Just prime factorize. Yes. So Puneet is answering here. There are a lot of Puneet I can see in the chat window right now. Okay. So, and let me tell you, the GMAT would often come across such kind of numbers so that, this values can be definitely written in these terms. Maybe, not matchable with the power that, you may require 2 more powers to it therein where that it requires 5 squared more. These are the sort of the questions that happens into probabilities and permutation, especially in permutation. So 1372, write it as prime factor. I'll quickly take a note from here. It says it's 2 times 2, 2 squared and 7 cubed. If we compare this with this, exponent property has tell us that 2 squared and 7 cubed, 2 to the power A, 7 to the power B. Okay, I got it. So we could definitely say that B would be equals to 3, comparing the same basis. Answer cannot be D here just because of the fact that we don't know. If A is 2, what is the value of B? There's no relation between A and B. Don't fall for keeping the values here. This is why this condition says they are independent. And they will definitely try giving us this particular values. And if this A changes, then there would be a lot of A equals to 2A. B, what will be B? Even if A equals to 100, you cannot find B. Whatever the value of AB, it's only case you can write that 1372. And therein where you can actually talk about the now this is wherein I'll talk about the now this is wherein I'll talk about in general what we have done so far very quickly. And to solve A, it is tricking us to consume more time. See, 137. I tell you one thing, Puneet. What happens in this sort of questions is be prepared with the fact that GMAT often comes up with such numbers therein where the expression can be expressed. Okay. So this is, I tell you, right now A is taking much of your time, but whatever the time you have, not wasted, you have saved while directly checking it to A, not falling for C, B or something, is more than enough for you to take a step to, you know, go ahead with A. But just practice for some more prime factorization, do some mental calculations as like, you know, how could the numbers would be, and then therein where it would work. Chen, I meant to say, suppose you get to know that California has, if I tell you, Chen, that California has told us, California has experienced a severe rainfall. So you will say, okay, then what is the temperature in Adelaide? So you would be confused about why am I talking about Adelaide when I'm giving you the information for California. So when I'm telling you that A is 2, which alphabet other than A can you find out after those 26 letters in, or left out 25 letters in English? You cannot, right? So this is wherein, so let's go with this slide. What does it say? Apply the variable approach. That is first, quickly check how many variables equations are given, how many are needed. Then answer C, key question. The first thing first is key questions, integers, and statistics. See, C is more frequent in integers and statistics. C is the less frequent in probability, inequality, and absolute value question. Chen, you can find the value of B by putting value of a value of A from two equation, that is true. But why are you forgetting a fact that that's an integer question? You don't have to combine. I got my answer is C without even looking at the conditions. There were two variables. I need two equation. I can get easily C. Why do I have to solve it when my A alone is giving me an answer? So that is wherein we have learned before marking C as an answer in integer sort of questions. Make sure that you check A and B separately. If it is not the key question, then you can definitely probable answer is C. Just go ahead, check it. If it is a key question, then definitely apply common mistake type 3, which says conditions are independent. And common mistake type 4, A or B, which says if C seems to be an answer, please restrict yourself, check A and B. Either of the equation is looking easy to you, don't mark it. There could be possible answer of D as well. So in this particular scenario, when we talk about the CMTs, there are a lot of questions that you would get through on the lesson plans as well. And a lot of, trivial level questions also, therein where this particular applications would show you the beauty. And therein where you will be able to master it because, this is wherein we'll take time for it. But again, I repeat, the topics which you need to strengthen or in which you as a respective people are actually struggling with, I would suggest, try variable approach and finish off that particular topic with it, you will be done. That's a very basic, you know, concept. What is the standard deviation of 10 numbers? Question is statistics. 10 numbers. How many variables do I have? 10 variables. When I have a 10 variables, how many equations do I need? 10 equations. Okay. I have just two conditions. Maximum, I can get two equations. Where will those 8 equations come from? They cannot come from anywhere. My answer should be possibly E. This is a variable approach which I have applied that tells me to mark an answer E, I have to make sure that I check C and all so that, you know, when combined or taken individually, at the end, I can mark the answer as E. What I'll do is I'll combine both the situations together. The sum of any two numbers of this 10 number is 8. And the average of this 10 number is 4. If the average of all this 10 number is 4, I can say all the numbers are 4. So the standard deviation becomes 0. And sum of any two numbers of this 10 numbers is 8. Don't fall for this. That this sum 8 can be taken as 2 plus 6 also, please. It's a sum of any two numbers. What if I don't select 6? It's like you pick any two numbers out of those 10, the sum would be 8. So they all have to be same. If they all have to be same, the standard deviation happens to be what? 0. C seems to be an answer. It's statistics question. Puneet has got the answer. So now see, this is wherein we get trapped. The sum of any two numbers of this 10 numbers is 8. Numbers can be 5 and 3. Yes. So all are 4. Sum is 4 plus 4 is 8. 5 plus 3. Third number can also be 5. So standard deviation will remain same. That would be 0. So my condition A is sufficient enough to answer the question. Then why do I have to combine? So E has out. E cannot be the answer. C is already out. I don't need to combine it. And that was eventually any which way is out because it's a statistics question. So before marking C, I have to check A and B. Now the only thing remains is either it sticks to A or it ends up with D. The average of this 10 number is 4. Now see, average of 10 number is 4. If one happens to be 0, then your permutation changes because all the numbers can be 4. Average would remain 4. If you change one of the number to 3, another can become 5. Because average is always affected by the outliers. So in this scenario, B is not sufficient. The logic which I have applied is more a concept of statistics. Therefore, I'm sorry if I was very fast applying it, but pertaining to the approach that we have learned, I again say C should have been an answer, but it's statistics. I'll definitely limit myself to a very simple concept, which is A and B. And when we go ahead with, okay, if you remember, I was talking at the start, there's something related to the question, understanding, the comprehension. Now, if you see the level of the questions that we are dealing right now, so far you had all the questions that were more or less value-oriented. Now, soon on the screen, you are able to see statements and the word problems, which is again a major problem that it creates when it comes to data sufficiency. So in this, you can take a time to comprehend it properly. Don't worry about you will be taking long time. The reason behind that is you still hold this variable and a common mistake type approach. So you know whatever time I'll take in comprehending a question will be automatically saved because I have got common mistake type in my mind to demystify those questions. So don't worry about the time. Now, if you remember, there was one word that I used, modify. modify the questions so that, you know, you can ultimately land up to one of the equations to be answered or both of the conditions to be the answer. So we'll be dealing now with this, the first step of the variable approach that we'll do. We'll try modifying difficult question. And there are three steps, you know, which we always do. This is a complete set of three steps that is done in variable approach. I'll just repeat it once because this has something which we've been doing from last 1.5 hours. What we do, we modify and recheck the original conditions and questions. So this is something which we have been doing very fast right now. But now this is something which we'll only do. I'm repeating, this is the only thing we will do now and get the answer. So do I mean that I don't have to follow the second or third step maybe? So let's see what is the drama here all in total. Let's see. But overall, the variable approach says quickly modify and recheck the question. Check the number of variables and equations in the original conditions. So this is what we have been doing. X and Y are positive integers. Okay, two integers. How many equations I do need? I need two equations. Where will I check it from? The conditions. See, match the number of variables. So this second and third step is something which I have followed for last 90 minutes. Now, next 15 minutes will be only focus on the first step or not? Let's see it. So the question says on the screen, which is about to get flashed, is all about, are we only applying the first step maybe, or are we going in detail? So it says, John has purchased 80 iPhones. My God, I think he is a very rich person because he's buying an iPhone and that too in bulk, that is 80. Anyways, John has purchased 80 iPhones for $30 each. Of the iPhones, N are sold for $40 each. And the rest are sold, that means 80 minus N, obviously, for dollar X. If the gross profit from the sales is $600, as X is less than 30, N is greater than 60, inequality involved, first thing. But question is not inequality. It's not a key question, guys. Please be attentive on this. It's not a key question. Key question has something in the question, not in the conditions. We've been trying for such a long statement, then we will read, we get to know what we best can do. How is this particular long statement which is given right now, which has got 80 is a number, $30, then N, then $40, then X, then 600, X, 30. So many numbers, so many values. And they're just giving me N. So are this particular question actually talking about N? So this is wherein I know that I have to modify this in order to use this. So in this scenario, if you modify 80 iPhones, I have $30 each. N has been sold for $40. So that happens to be 40N. The remaining iPhones would be definitely N minus 80. Because if I have $100 and if I give someone 20, I'll make it as 100 minus 20. That happens to be $80. Basic concept. So if there are N mobile phones out of 80, remaining are 80 minus N, which was sold for $X, and the addition of both is making a sale of 600. So total cost that was involved was $80 times $30, which is $2,400. This is what you were earning, and make sure that, you know, this 600 is not just the sales, but that is a profit. So it's a selling price minus cost price. So selling price would be 40N plus 80 minus N times X minus the cost price, which is 2,400. That is equal to 600. Just a simply multiplication can tell you that X is equals to 3,000 minus 40N over 80 minus N. Is X less than 30? Is this factor, is this fraction less than 30? Please cross multiply this to get to know 3000 minus 40N is less than 2400 minus 30N. Rearrange it to get to know the fact that how much is N and what are they talking about. So far, we are just modifying it. We are just modifying this equation. We just want to know that whether N is greater than 60. First condition says yes. Is A the answer? Will I not check B? I'll always check B. N is less than 70. That doesn't mean N is greater than 60. N less than 70 could be 40 as well, 45 as well, 59 as well. Even it can be. Right, so that is wherein I get an answer is A. Now see, the concern is, did I apply the second step of variable approach matching the variables and all? No, why? There were so many variables. That is wherein a catch, I can modify it. Second catch, the statement is so long, the condition given are so short. Definitely I require a modification. This is a catch. This is what we learn out of the modification. This is wherein you apply the modification. Similarly, we'll look for one more modification question, I guess, and that would be more or less giving us answer A by modification. So we modify and recheck the original condition. We'll see cases where answer A is the modification questions. So the first step of the variable approach and modify and recheck. So now see, you don't have to apply the second and the third step and all. You just do the modification. Any which way, don't worry. Your time is automatically getting saved because you still don't have to apply the second and the third equation. So you have time to apply such sort of, you know, steps, modifications. We'll try one more question right now that will be dealing with probability. There are X red balls, Y blue balls, Y green balls in box A. X is unknown, Y is unknown. Two different colors. Green is known, which is 5. One ball is selected at the random. Now see, when we select one ball at the random, it could be any ball, any. It could be the red or a blue or a green. But do I know how many red balls are there? No. Do I know how many Y balls are there? No. But do I know green? Yes, 5. Okay, fine. So it says that the probability that the ball selected is red greater than the probability that the ball selected is blue. First of all, the concern is we don't know how many red and blue we have. Secondly, they're asking about the comparison. Question is still in the form of word problem, the long word problems. Of conditions attached to it to support are what they are actually in terms of simple equations. Modification is one that I need. How can I actually compare the these words with the numbers? No, modification is something I'll require here. Fine. What is the probability that if I select this X balls, red, definitely X over total. So X over X plus Y plus 5. And what if a probability if I select blue, Y over X plus Y plus 5. So what is the question asking me? Red greater than probability of the ball selected is blue. Is red greater than blue? This is what they mean to say. Red greater than blue. That means X over X plus Y plus 5, is that greater than Y over X plus Y plus 5? Can I still go ahead and rearrange it? Depends upon, if I wish to rearrange it, I can definitely. But rather than rearranging it, if I see somewhere here, X plus Y plus 5 is greater than 0. Why it is greater than 0? Because we already have 5 green balls. So it is added. And probability, negative, possibility, negative. So the concern is, multiply this, cross multiply this. We need to find X times of this factor is greater than Y times of this factor. Multiply this X square and distribute this X, I would say. X plus Y is equals to 20. Okay, I'll come back to this. If you skip this, then that is a because this particular condition can also be an answer. So I cannot directly jump. And it's a probability question. Don't jump on B. So it's again, the concern is X over Y So I was just distributing this x inside and y this. If I go through this, I'll get this particular equation. A slight rearrangement of this particular condition or this equation would directly lend me to condition number one. Secondly, x plus y is equals to 20. X can be 11. Y equals to 9. X can be 12. Y equals to 3. Will the probability change? Total will not change because that both will give me 25, but probability would change. So this is why I'm saying, please be focused about the equations or the condition that seems very, very lucrative, because this is the trap which GMAT actually gives. They are not actually wanting that, you know, we should provide or frame a question that no one test taker would able to solve it. No. They don't want that, you know, such a hard question should be there in the test paper that none of the aspirant would have been able to solve it. And this is where we stand as a GMAT. No. They have a much better way to trap even the experts like you. And this is the trap that we are discussing today. Let's solve this question. Modulus of xy, absolute value question, guys. Please pay attention. It's a key question. It could be. Plus xy is greater than 0. Can we modify it? Mod of xy, not necessary. It's always negative. Whether xy is greater than 0. So this is wherein, you know, if you modify the questions, therein where you have upper hand on solving. And where to modify when you get a long statements and you have a very short values in the conditions, modify. When you have some comparisons to be made, I would say modify. And therein where you can make out the answers with the modification. Condition 2 directly is giving me xy is greater than 0. Because the mod of xy would has to be positive. Where this value would be the major case. If this happens to be greater than 0, this whole would be positive. Otherwise, it could be negative also. So concern is second option is giving me xy is greater than 0. This is done. No, it's absolute value. I'll just make sure that, you know, I'm checking A also. But if x is less than 0, then this y is still unknown. So it can give me either of the values, which is yes or no. So this is wherein I can make my mind very quickly. And why did I am just checking A also in this when I'm pretty sure that B is the correct answer? Just to make sure one fact that this is an absolute value question. So if B seems easy or A seems easy, I have to hold. I'll quickly check the other ones. Checking this in this scenario will not be that difficult. You can definitely. So see, whatever amount of time you save into, you know, getting to know about which could be the answer, where to start my steps, where to, you know, think about, right? Where to think about the, you know, I would say, I mean, like, where should I step my process from? Where should I start my solution from? Start from the variable approach. Start from the variable approach, at least you know what you have been ending with, what you've been finding with, rather than just thinking about what could be the answer. Variable approach will let you know what could be the answer. The only case is common mistake type 3. Just pay attention to common mistake type 3, 4A, 4B. Just don't get into marking the answer. And I'm telling it to you people, Q45 if you are on, Q50 is in your reach. Q47 is you if you are on. But if you would say, if Q47 if you are on, but again, that is not consistent, this is the step that will bring it to consistency. And to support all your answers, because I was more focused upon the sessions, I have not been through much about the chat today. But yes, again, I have been very much, I felt very good when, you know, you have actually been a part of this session today. You found a time. And I'm pretty sure that it will add up a lot of values to your learning. Anyone who's starting from the scratch is blessed because he'll be just learning one thing, and that is variable approach, and is thorough. For more, what you could do best is you can visit our website, that is www.mathrevolution.com. Sign up, have access to our material for free for 7 days. And there is a tab which says one-on-one live sessions. You can book your slots to talk to me about your preparation, about your score consistency, about your performances. And definitely, I would like to answer and support. It's not only I, but we as a Math Revolution, as a whole, as a team, would definitely be in a position to support you in the best manner we can. Be it our resources, be it our approaches, everything is worth finding it. So I'll take a leave for now. You all have a great night or a great day ahead. Stay blessed. Keep practicing. Keep preparing. And Abhijit, I'm so thankful to you for such a well arrangement therein. You know, I have brought this today to these students across the globe. I mean, thank you so much for this, because now I know that, you know, students would feel better because they've got something now to crack through GMAT. Right. So I'll just take a leave now. And yeah, that is it. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, just keep posted to us through info@mathrevolution.com. That's a pretty well designated email therein where you could shoot your emails. And definitely the any of the representative will email it, send it to you, revert you back. And if you, in case particularly, want to talk more about it, then you can talk with our experts any moment of time. So with that message, I wish your preparation go very good and great day. Thank you so much and have a lovely day. Abhijit, you there?